slightly outdated version of these slides, but hopefully we'll make do. So I'm so excited to be here. My name is Michael Place. I am from Salt Lake City, Utah. So I'm a long way from home. And I am the principal maintainer of the Salt Stack project. And
what I'm going to do is I would like to talk a little bit today about the sorts of things that I wish somebody had told me about when I was starting out in open source in the mid-90s now. It would have been about 94, 95 when I first started out. And before I begin, let me tell you a little bit about the project that I work on. We have a very large Python-based project. It's about, depending on how you count it, somewhere between 700,000 and about a million lines of code. We have about 1,000 active developers, and it was started in 2011, not by me, but by my good friend Thomas Hatch. And currently, we're at about 75,000 commits. We have about 4,000 open GitHub issues. So if you ever look at one of your projects and you feel like you have a lot of bugs, try having 4,000 of them. It makes it a little hard to sleep at night some days. Typically, we get between about 100 and 150 pull requests every week, which is a lot of code flying around. Anybody who's familiar with GitHub knows that that level of change is kind of insane. It's not the greatest in the world, but it's a lot. To give you a better idea of what that actually constitutes, about every 7 days, we change somewhere between about 50 and 100,000 lines of code. That's additions and deletions. That is a serious amount of code flying around. So you can imagine to yourself the sorts of problems that happen there. Things like, how do I keep this stable? How do I keep this tested? How do I ensure that when somebody submits new code, that it's not going to break something else? We provide support for about a dozen different platforms, which makes things even more challenging. Because you know, typically, if you're, let's say, a Django developer, right? You write things, and you know, for Django, like maybe you have to worry about which version of Django you're on. But more or less, that's kind of it. We have to sort of track and work with about a dozen operating systems, some of which are new and some of which are not quite so new. Actually, last night, while I was unable to sleep, got into a big discussion with some of the folks back home. We actually have to support Python 2.6, which is insane. And not only do we have to support Python 2.6, but we have to support Python 2.6 while we migrate to support for Python 3.4 as well. Those of you who have ever done or are engaged in a Python 2-3 transition, imagine trying to support 2.6 and then trying to move to 3.4 without dropping your 2.6 support, and then do it for a million lines of code and 12 supported platforms. We have about 1,700 developers, of which about 1,000 typically are active at any given time, about 7,000 GitHub stars. And like I mentioned before, our ecosystem, depending on how you count it, makes up somewhere between about 750,000 lines to about a million lines of Python. Not the biggest Python project in the world, but certainly not the smallest. On a typical day, our automated test infrastructure runs about 6 million automated tests. Not 6 million different tests, it's actually about 6,000 different tests, but because we have so much code changing all the time and we're trying to manage this code across a dozen different platforms, our testing needs become very complex very quickly. So what do I do? I'm the project maintainer. I very rarely sleep. I slept about 2.5 hours last night. And why is it that I very rarely sleep? I very rarely sleep because open source is so exciting. The first day I got hired to do my job, I walked in sort of excited and not really knowing what to expect, and left that day feeling like I had been strapped to a rocket ship and nobody was willing to let me off. Why did I feel like that? Because open source is a global phenomenon. And for typical software developers that maybe work in a regular office, typically, you know, you come in, you write some code, and then at the end of the day, you know, you go home. And when you come in the next morning, things are as you left them. Aha, that would be nice. But no, as it turns out, in a large project like ours, what happens is I go to sleep, and then France wakes up, and they decide to do a bunch of French things and change everything around. And I wake up in the morning, and I'm like, oh, mon Dieu, nothing works. And so doing project maintenance is both exciting and terrifying all at the same time. But you know, when back before I started in open source, I always really wondered about what do these project maintainers do all day, right? What's actually happening in this open source ecosystem? And more importantly, how do I get involved in it? So when I was a wee lad back in the early 90s, I used, you know, some open source software. This was before Python was even really a thing. But used, you know, open source software like Mailman, for example. And it always felt to me like open source was something that other people did, right? It wasn't really clear to me how to get engaged in this community. For myself, I used to think, A, open source is something only for developers, right? At the time, I was not a particularly active developer. I was a sysadmin. And so I thought, oh, well, this isn't something I could possibly participate in. Of course, things were more difficult back then. We didn't have things like GitHub that make it a lot easier now than it was back then. But at the same time, it really felt like sort of this high and mighty community, right, that was off somewhere else that I just couldn't understand how to participate in. And so I would go out, you know, and I would kind of ask people, hey, you know, it looks like you're involved in open source, how do you do this? And they would give, really frankly, kind of the same bad answers that you get today. Right? Because right now, if you Google around and you want to say to yourself, oh, okay, you know, open source, that sounds really great. How do I participate in that? You'll come up with, you know, some blog posts, and most of them say something along the lines of, well, maybe you can file a bug, or if you're not a developer, maybe you can write some documentation. And, you know, they maybe will explain how to, you know, participate in a user group, but nothing really beyond that. And so the goal of what I want to talk about today is some best practices and some concrete steps that everybody in this room can take to participate in open source in their own way. So what's the first step? The first step to contributing to free software is using free software. And this seems like a really obvious point, but it took me 15 years to get it around my head, right? That if you're a user of free software, you already have your ticket in the door. Now let me tell you the number one reason that that almost no open source developers will tell you why this is important. It's because open source developers, for the most part, especially in really large, fast-moving projects, don't have good insight into what it's like to use the software that they write. And this sounds crazy, right? But it's actually true. Maintainers of large projects spend so much time on the internals or doing feature work or doing bug fixing. If you're doing that 7 or 8 or 9 hours a day, you don't have any time to actually use the thing that you build. And so it feels in many ways like you're doing all of this with blinders on. And so from a project maintainer's perspective, we count on people who use free software to be our eyes and ears to help guide the project. Because so many times there's this notion that if you're a user of free and open source software, that the people who are writing it, those people over there, right, have this plan and they understand what it looks like and all of that. But from the inside, we're actually depending on the users to tell us in many ways what the plans are, what the bugs are, what works right, what doesn't work right, so on and so forth. It has to be a collaborative relationship, and many people who are new to open source find that to be really surprising. I know I did. So the first thing that I set out to do when back in the 90s when I wanted to get involved in open source, I was like, oh, okay, Apache, I know Apache, right? Like, you know, I'll go out and I'll start contributing to Apache. Well, that was a terrible idea, right? And why was that a terrible idea? Because Apache is super complicated, right? And it's really hard to start to get into. In fact, Apache, if you go to their website, they have this huge page that explains in depth how to participate in the project, but it's extremely intimidating for people coming in from the outside. And so the first bit of advice that I want to give to people about trying to contribute to open source is don't necessarily go for the big fish, for these huge, fast-moving projects. It's like trying to jump into the deep end of the pool. There are thousands, if not tens of thousands of projects that move much, much slower and would be much so grateful for your help. So you don't need to jump directly in to the deep end necessarily. So let's say you want to do this. Let's say you want to join an open source project. The first thing that you can do to start to get involved is to actually talk about the project, to talk about it online, to participate in mailing lists, or even to give feedback on social media. If you think that when you complain about a bug in Django on Twitter that the Django developers don't see that, you are totally wrong. I guarantee you they have a filter set up to watch the sort of comments that come back. Almost every project maintainer in the world does. And so they'll see that feedback if you start talking about it in public, be it good or be it bad. And so the first step is to simply talk about your experiences with the software that you're using. And part of that, of course, is telling your story. Oh, here's Gnome deciding to throw some arrows up. And we're going to get into this much more in a couple of minutes. But don't be afraid to file a bug, right? I used to be terribly afraid of this because I used to think to myself, gosh, you know, if I file a bug, they might ask me questions that I don't know the answer to. They may make fun of me. And the scary thing about open source, and I think you have to acknowledge this, is that open source is open, right? It's really fun for me day to day because as I go throughout my day, if I make a mistake, hey, 1,000 people get to see it, right? That's super fun. But that can be really scary. And so I'm here to tell you that although that seems scary on the outside, really good, healthy, active open source communities will make it okay to say that you might not know the answer to something. And if you want to contribute to a project, any project that you use, and you don't know how to, there's a really simple way, which is just to ask. Every project in the world has contact information about the project. If you're confused about how to jump in, ask. Email them and tell them where you're coming from, tell them your story, and say, I want to help, can you give me a place to start? And I guarantee you they will be so, so, so thrilled. What I want to do in this talk is combine some best practices when it comes to software development with best practices about, for lack of a better word, being a human being. Because in the open source community, believe it or not, this stuff really matters. When I first started out, I used to think that open source was like this, that it was a meritocracy, right? That simply the best idea was always the one that was going to get chosen, right? And as a project maintainer, I am here to tell you that is so false. Right? Open source doesn't work because this person proposes an idea and then this person proposes an idea and then they fight and then the person with a better idea is the one that wins in the end. Open source maintainers and open source projects are made up of human beings. And human beings take so many other things into account than simply the quality and efficiency of the code that's being presented. They take the trustworthiness of a person, whether or not a person is kind to them, for example. As much as it sort of pains me to admit it, if a person is a jerk to me at a conference, right, and then a week later, you know, they say, ah, I used your software, it was terrible, it had this bug, and I say, okay, well, that's fine, software has bugs, life is hard. I say, you know, you're welcome to send in a fix. And they say, and they say a bunch of nasty things to me. And this happens from time to time. And then a week later, they send in this bug fix. I would love to say that I treat it in the same way that I treat a bug fix that comes in from someone that said, hey, you know, I used your software. It's great. It didn't work quite right. Kindness matters. And virtue matters when it comes to open source. And so I was thinking about how to sort of declare what this virtuous framework should look like for open source developers. And I came back to the notion of being a 10-year-old kid back home in Utah. And when I was a 10-year-old boy, I joined the Boy Scouts. And Boy Scouts are this group, they go out, they do, you know, hiking, camping, fishing, all this stuff, right? They have sort of this code of conduct. And it popped into my head, and it made me realize that it applies perfectly, I think, to the open source world. And I want to run through that really quick and look at the virtues that the Boy Scouts thought were important, so that as we continue our discussion, you can refer back to each of these virtues and see how they might apply. The first one is trustworthiness, right? That should be obvious. Now, one of the key things about trustworthiness, especially as it applies to open source, is the ability to trust in another person's acceptance of your ignorance, and for you to trust for you to accept their ignorance. What do I mean by this? It's really scary to get up in a group and participate in a discussion, and somebody asks you a question, and to have to say, "I don't know," right? Like, that's really lousy. But I'll tell you this. Over the course of my career, I've had to interview a lot of different software developers. And I only have one rule about interviewing software developers. And that is, if a software developer during an interview doesn't know the answer to the question and they try to fake it, if they try to, you know, come at it and try to convince me that maybe they know, instead of saying, you know what, I don't know the answer to that, I'm sorry, let's move on, they're done, right? The number one rule of open source and of software development in general is to be able to trust the people that you're working with and to be able to foster a relationship with those individuals on your team in which it is always okay for anybody on the team to say that they don't know. Loyalty. That dovetails nicely into what we were just talking about. In open source, especially in large, fast-moving projects, A lot of times, you know, just like in a school or in politics or what have you, alliances will form. You know, people will begin to group themselves into different teams. Sometimes this presents challenges because if people are not loyal to the health of the project or the health of the software that you're trying to produce, if their loyalty is to these little teams instead of to each other, instead of to the quality of the work that they're doing, you'll never produce any good software. Helpfulness, right? This should be completely obvious. A lot of times when you go to a new project and you begin to gauge whether or not it's something that you might want to use even in your day-to-day work, it can be challenging, right? You might say, oh, you know, I'm a web developer and I want to use this great new JavaScript library or what have you, so you kind of go and you read about it, right? The one way I always try to gauge the health of a software project is to go and look at the mailing list and see how helpful people are. If the people in your community and the people on your teams are not willing not just to answer questions, but to go out of their way to be helpful, to take that extra step, it's tough to create something that's really sustainable. People have to be friendly. This should go without saying, but it's so hard, or it's so easy not to realize the importance of being friendly with the people that you work with. And this comes into play not just in your verbal interaction, but even in your approach to software development. Because I think we can all go back and we can look at cases where a person has written some code, which for lack of a better description, just isn't friendly, right? It's got a hard interface, it's difficult to integrate into the rest of the platform. The developer of the code is not friendly to people who might come along later who might need to use it, for other developers on the team who might need to integrate with it. Friendliness has to be a virtue. People need to be courteous in their software development. What do I mean by courtesy? I mean that we need to defer and listen to each other, and not just listen in a casual way, but listen in an active way, ensuring that we're always asking the right questions of each other. One of the most worrisome aspects day to day in my job as a software maintainer is when I feel like people are not asking the proper questions. This, I think, above everything else, is most important. We have one rule in our project, and it's a very simple rule, and it served us well for many years, and that rule is, don't be a jerk. If you are a jerk to other people, even if you write the best code in the world, if somebody else is on your team and they're a brilliant programmer but they're a jerk, lose them. Lose them, lose them, lose them. The code they are writing is not worth it. It will destroy the health of your project. It will make it difficult for other people to contribute. Nothing is more corrosive than an individual in a project who is not kind. We need to be thrifty. We need to ensure that, you know, when we're writing code, that we're actually aware of the needs of other people, right? Which is to say, it may not seem like a big deal to us. For example, one of the things I have to deal with day to day, I'll get a code contribution that comes in, somebody, you know, they'll have, you know, written a little bit of tail recursion in, right? And they'll say, oh, well, it's not a big deal, you know, and like the unit test, it was fine, yada, yada, yada. And I'll say, no. You don't understand the notion that we can't just build this for your use case, we have to build it for the generalized use case. So even if you're not concerned about efficiency, other people are going to be. Bravery. I think this is a really underrated virtue in the open source community, because it takes a lot of bravery to make your voice heard, to participate in a way that is respectful, in a way that you don't have to show off. And we'll get this from time to time. Every few months, a new developer will show up to the project. And most of the time, it's a developer who's in this this sort of confidence bubble, I like to call it, right? And usually that happens anywhere, right? For me, the best test cases that I get are the ones that have a paragraph or two paragraphs that explain the bug, explain how they came to see it, they explain how to reproduce it, and then they say, oh, okay, if you need to do it, here's 10 lines or 15 lines of code that you can use. Right now, this 15 lines of code does X. I expected it to do Y. When it does X, bug is fixed. Developer is like, yes, right? That's a bug they're going to want to work on, because they have an authoritative way to know that they've achieved the goal of fixing the bug report, right? A lot of times, you know, we'll get bugs, you know, and it'll be like, well, you know, I did X, and then just kind of this weird thing happened, and I didn't really capture any logs, so I don't know. And they don't stop to think to themselves, well, what is someone supposed to do with that, right? Like, of course I'm going to come back to them and be like, well, we need logs. I'm sorry you didn't get some, but I can't do anything until you provide the data that I need. Simply not having it just isn't a good excuse. So depending on the project, certainly with our project, bugs at the in the develop branch are far easier to fix, because the code is more fluid, right? It's where active feature development is happening, so on and so forth. But bugs that are in release branches are often more critical. And I think this is good to know when you're filing a bug report, what the attitude of the developer who fixes it is likely to be. They're very likely to prioritize the bug that is in the release branch, right? Because they're thinking to themselves, oh goodness, there are people out in the world who are experiencing this bug, right? And so that's where the criticality comes in. And then usually what happens is kind of at the end of the day, when they're ready to relax and they don't want to think hard, they turn to the bugs that exist in the develop branch where the feature work is going on, because those are fun to fix, right? Because those bugs, you can sort of do whatever you like, right? Because you don't have to worry about as much about regression potential. They can be a little bit more playful and a little bit more fun to fix. So, this is important, and we see this mistake happen all the time, is that tests should be done against both the branch where you see the bug happening, as well as the branch where active development is happening, right? This is actually probably the number one mistake I see with bugs that come in from the community, right? Because what they'll say is, oh, okay, I'm running version 5 of the software that you made, and I tried to do X and it did Y, there's a bug. And I'll say, great, but we've been, you know, developing this code for 8 months since version Y was released. Have you tested it against the head of the branch? And they'll say no, and then I'll go, okay. And then I have to, you know, go through the whole test case. If you, as a person who's reporting the bug, are able to say, you know what, I pulled down today's build, right? Or I pulled down the code from today, and it's still broken, that's going to increase your chances dramatically, because then that person knows, or that developer knows, hey, I'm not going to have to spend this time to try to reproduce this and chase this down, only to discover that it's already been fixed, which happens all the time. So, packaging test cases. I'm actually becoming a huge fan of this approach in software development. I will not give you my whole Church of Docker speech, but Docker is great for some things, not so good for other things, but one of the things that Docker is outstanding at is being able to create isolated test cases that you can easily pass around to people, right? You know, back years ago, when you had to file a bug report, you had to sort of, you know, describe the steps or maybe, you know, produce some sample code and attach that. Now, one of the great things that we can do is we can say, oh, look, you don't need to do any of that. I have created my test case in a Docker container. I've uploaded the thing to Docker Hub. All you have to do is go out, pull it down, run this command, and you'll see what I'm talking about. Oh, hallelujah, it's fantastic. So if you can do this, the chances of your bug getting fixed are going to go way up. If there are lots of dependencies necessary, you may want to consider packaging up a virtual EMV environment and providing that along with them. Again, it's all about reducing the amount of time that it takes for a developer to reproduce the code. So, does this bug matter, right? One of the things to always explain in a bug report is how this bug affects you specifically, because believe it or not, it's not always easy to tell, right? Especially in a really large, really broad project, right? They may say, oh, I tried to do X and, you know, your software did Y. And then I go, okay, so what, right? Does that mean your systems are down? Does that mean that you were mildly inconvenienced? Do you expect other people to have their systems down, or do you expect them to be mildly inconvenienced? That makes a big difference. How might it affect others? We mentioned that. And the best kind of bug report just reads like a use case in a design document. Lots of plain language, lots of terms which are easy to understand. Now, when filing a bug report, it's important to be aware of the culture that you're dealing with, right? Every now and then, I'll get bug reports which are not in English, which is fine. I understand that not everybody speaks English, but I also don't speak every language in the world. And I just want to fix bugs. And if the bug report is written in such a way that I can't understand what the person is talking about, sometimes I'll have to contact them privately and say, hey, you know, can we get you in touch with a user group somewhere in the area who can help with the translation so that we can get this into the language that's native to the development community? Culture is big there too. Sometimes it's important to realize that not every culture has the same approach. What might be normal in one culture for somebody to be very frank and sort of brusque about how a bug is operating might be very offensive to another culture. This happens a lot of the time. And it's important, too, to respect personal and professional boundaries in filing bug reports and to respect time zones. Last year, I had a developer who was in Europe, and he liked to drink wine, I think. And he would like to drink wine and file bug reports. The problem is that he would do this at you know, about midnight his time, which was like about 4 a.m. my time, and he would get really frustrated, and then he would start like calling me on Instant Messenger, and he just like wouldn't be aware, and you think this is crazy, but when you have a project with 1,000 or 2,000 or 3,000 people, not everybody is respectful of where everybody else lives, and it's, believe it or not, something you actually need to be considered. The final thing about filing a good bug report is don't be a stranger, all right? That the way that this process usually works when a bug comes into an open source project is that typically there'll be a team or some individuals who are designed to triage that bug, right? And so typically they'll ask a couple of questions, they'll try to get to the point where a developer can look at it. And so you'll get really excited, right? You'll have like a good back and forth for a couple hours and you'll be like, great, and you'll be like, oh, I'm on my way. And then nothing happens for a year. Right, and you'd be like, what happened? What did I do wrong? You didn't necessarily do anything wrong. It's just that the triage happened, and then it got put into a queue to have the bug fixed. And forgive me, I'm running a little bit over time. Is that okay? Okay. Okay. Yeah. I'll try to be quick. The next section I want to talk about is contributing. How to actually send in code, be it features or bug fixes or what have you, in such a way that it's extremely likely that your bug fixes will be merged. Because remember, again, it's not a meritocracy. A lot of other things matter. When contributing, especially to a project that you haven't contributed to before, typically projects will have a contributing file. It'll be right in the head of the project, right in the top level directory. Always pop this open and read it. It will tell you everything you need to know, right? Do they expect tests to be written, yes or no? Do they have a style guide that you need to adhere to, yes or no? Do they have a contributor agreement that you need to sign, yes or no? If you read all of that stuff first, it's going to take all the burden off from whoever triages your issue from having to go back and forth and do that process with you, because you know they have to do it 50 times a day, and it doesn't usually endear that person to the project. Does the bug have an issue number? A lot of times, not a lot of times, but often we'll get code sent in really without any explanation at all, right? It'll be like, oh, this fixes this bug that I saw. Thanks, have a nice day. And I'll be like, okay, I can't merge this because I don't understand the context. I never had a bug report to begin with. Some projects about this are stricter than others, but the story at the end of the day is always ensure that you have filed a bug report or a feature proposal before you send in code, especially with feature proposals, because a lot of the times what will happen is I'll wake up one day and I'll start looking at code that's come in and somebody has written 2,000 lines and they're like, oh, this is great, it's super elaborate. And I can't merge it. And if they had talked to someone, if they had opened an issue and spent 30 minutes going back and forth before they wrote all this code, we wouldn't have to spend 2 weeks getting it to the point where it needs to be in order for it to be merged. Bugs, features should always have an issue number associated with them before they come in. Have you read the style guide? Sometimes in Python, this is just PEP8. Other projects have a more elaborate style guide. The founder of our project doesn't like double quotes and doc strings. That's just his thing. And so like there are just no double quotes and doc strings anywhere. And if you send one in, like he'll just be like, well, needs to be single quotes because he was dropped on his head or something. I don't know. So what do all good contributions have? They all adhere to the style guide. They've been tested against all applicable versions, right? One thing that's critical for good contributions is that good contributions only contain changes that are relevant to the issue in question. The number one way to get your bug fix or your feature rejected, especially bug fixes, is to send in 500 lines of which 10 lines are the actual bug fix, and then you decided that you wanted to fix the grammar in a bunch of documentation in a bunch of different other places, right? Or you decided that the code wasn't vertical enough for you, or you decided that you wanted to refactor something over in this other function. Don't do that, right? Limit your bug fix to the actual bug fix. If you want to send in a refactor, great, but it needs to be in its own submission. If you mix and match, the problem is when someone is looking at this code on the other end, I have to look at it and I have to say, oh, okay, well, this person, wrote this bug fix, and here's a line that looks like it's related, but they also changed all this other code here. Is that just because they thought this was stylistically bad or what have you? We're not mind readers. We don't know. So please don't mix and match. Don't try to show off. It's totally obvious when people are trying to show off, right? If someone writes like a 5-line dictionary comprehension, I'm just like, just no, right? Like, I get it, you're super smart, but a lot of people in the project are super smart. Write it so it's reasonable. Write it so that it's easy for other people to understand. I know that we can all do really fancy things. Don't do it. Often really young, inexperienced developers think the fancier, the better. The opposite is true. Fanciness equals magic. Magic equals bad. Good contributions are always upfront about the possible downsides. They write in caveats. They say, this works, I've tested it. However, I did not test it for these cases. I've been thinking it could have this side effect. Making all of that stuff known is a good way to ingratiate yourself to a project. And finally, of course, good contributions are readable. So let's avoid these things. A lot of times, especially in developers, will want to add themselves to the contributors file, or to the authors file. That should be authors, forgive my typo there, before they've really contributed. Don't do this, it's really bad form. Merge conflicts, this happens all the time, especially for people who are doing feature work, right? So what'll happen is somebody will pull down, you know, a branch, do work for a week, not realizing that there's 1,000 other developers working on this project. They send it to me. I can't merge it at all because that code has changed 3 times, you know, in the time that they pulled the branch down and the time that I tried to merge it. If you send in merge conflicts, everybody's going to be frustrated. So to avoid that, just make sure that you get rebase or that you get pull into your feature branch before you send it in. If you don't do that, you're going to look silly. Don't modify code without notifying the appropriate people. Understand how to use things like git blame. If you see code and you're working to fix a particular bug and you see that the entire file is written by one person, when you send in your bug fix, it's especially polite to notify or CC that person because even if you don't, the maintainer probably is going to have to hunt that person down. If you do that work ahead of time, thumbs up, right? Don't submit broken tests in PRs because a lot of times because we have to keep the builds clean, right? While it might be a fine way for you to demonstrate that something is broken, I can't merge something that's going to break the build. So it's just going to sit there unmerged and be irritating for everyone because you're not going to get your stuff merged, and we can't merge it because it'll break the build. Don't do that. And work in progress pull requests without a good reason. A lot of times people do this, they'll say, instead of going, oh, okay, I've got this great idea for a feature, I'm gonna file an issue and have the discussion take place, they'll just go out, they'll write the 2,000 lines of code, send it in, and then the discussion will take place based on the code. That's usually suboptimal, right? Have the discussion first. And we mentioned this, never use vulgar or inappropriate language in any form, even in jest, because open source is not an appropriate place to do that. Other people may disagree. For us, we prefer that not happen. Be sure to agree to disagree, because you need to recognize, especially when contributing to open source, that the maintainers of the project may have considerations that you simply aren't aware of. And they might have to tell you no. They're not telling you no because they don't like you. They're telling you no potentially because of historical reasons, or they happen to know that this huge deployment out in the world uses this particular feature and that changing it is going to be really disruptive for them. That's not your problem, but you need to respect that it is the maintainer's problem because they're the ones that are going to get yelled at, not you. If they tell you no, they probably have a good reason. Always keep the conversations on topic. This is important. And don't just be polite, but we like to call it being irrationally polite, right? Be almost ridiculously polite to the point of being excited when you talk to other people. And we actually think this is really important. We use a lot of exclamation points. When somebody sends in a pull request, we say, "Ah, this is great, thank you so much," right? Because that stuff really matters. So, good Python is a good citizen to its neighbors, especially in a large project. Uses configuration values to gate changes wherever this is appropriate. A lot of times people will want to change behavior and not recognize that there are other people using the software. And so usually we'll have to go back and we'll have to say, hey, this is all fine, but you need to make a switch so that a person can turn this on or off if they don't want it. Good Python for us doesn't use keyword ordering. And by that I mean, in Python, if you have a series of keywords, keyword arguments in a function, you can pass those in when calling the function, or you can call the function just with a series of arguments and they will get mapped to the keywords in that order. That creates really tight coupling and is the source of many bugs. Please never do that. And good Python is visually pleasing. Finally, good Python is free of what we call weasel words. We know something is going to be trouble, for example, if somebody uses the word maybe, or I think, or things like that, right? If somebody leaves a comment and says, I think this does this, then I'm like, well, does it or doesn't it? Because we actually need to know. Guessing isn't going to work. And so if you find yourself writing code comments or bug reports and saying, you know, and you're unable to be specific about what's happening, it's a sign that you may need to do more work to get there. And of course, good Python is modular. Whoops, which I apparently wrote twice. Okay, so last section. I apologize, I made way too many slides, so please forgive my verbosity. I want to talk about setting out on your own, about the sorts of things that you can do if you choose to make your own project for other people to use. The best way to think about this is this Japanese art. I was fortunate to be in Japan just recently, and one of the things they showed us when we were there was that they very much celebrate the notion of imperfection, right? They call this wabi-sabi. In our office, we have a saying that we use all the time. I use it almost every day. Which is that you should never let the perfect be the enemy of the good, right? That in open source especially, okay, in many ways imperfection is desirable because imperfection is how we make progress. If you submit something that is imperfect, somebody else can come along and make it slightly better, and then somebody else can come along and make it slightly better. So often in open source, we don't do something because we believe that it's not perfect. One of the things that that we do, and I very rarely tell this story, is that if you follow Salt et al., you'll see that every now and then I'll write code or documentation that has misspellings or grammatical mistakes in it. I have an English literature degree. I don't make a lot of spelling mistakes on accident. I do it intentionally. And here's why I do it intentionally. Because it drives good programmers crazy, right? We get more good programmers from making tiny little spelling mistakes intentionally here and there than we do from almost anywhere else, because they see it and they can't let it go, right? And you can use that to your advantage. Oh, my slide there was out of order. So the first thing to ask yourself is, when considering making a new project for others to use, is what is the problem to which this is a solution? Until you can clearly articulate what that looks like, it's probably not time to put that code in the world. The more you work on it, the more that the answer to this question becomes clear. When you're ready to answer this question in a single sentence, you're ready to start sharing your work. A project is ready to be shared as soon as it has the simplest possible answer to the problem. And forgive me as I kind of move quickly because I'm very much over time. A new project should have a couple of things, and this is typically just known as a skeleton, but this is one of the things I wished I had known when I started creating projects many years ago and nobody used them. The first thing a good project should have is it should have a README. In that README, it should discuss the problem that you're trying to solve. A README is almost like a business plan for your project, right? This is what I'm going to set out to do. This is what it will look like when it does the thing it set out to do. Here's the problem that I was facing, and here's the solution that I've come up with. Right? Explain how you propose to solve the problem, any caveats that you might see, and explain to people in the README who want to use your project how to get started. So many projects out there in the world just don't contain this. They have a bunch of code, and it might be great, brilliant code, but they didn't take the 10 minutes to actually explain how to use it. And then, weirdly enough, nobody ever uses it. Go figure. Explain what to do when you get stuck. Explain how to contribute. New projects should contain an author's file. Will tell people who has been contributing to the project, and believe it or not, having an author's file actually kind of acts as a little bit of bait for good developers, because good developers have a little bit of ego, and it's kind of nice to sort of see your name in lights a little bit. If you have an author's file, then it signals to developers that come along, hey, this is something I can contribute, and when I do, my name will be, you know, preserved here for The nice thing too is that as you go along and you contribute to open source and you have your name in all these authors files, believe me, if there is one thing that will get you a job faster than anything else, one is having daily activity on GitHub, and two is having your name and email address in authors files. Because let me tell you, recruiters go and they look for that stuff. And when you wonder, you know, why there are job applications flying around and none of them ever seem to hit you, believe me, they look in there. I've done experiments on this where I've pulled my name out of the author's file to see how it would affect the number of emails that I get. And, you know, it's not substantially less, but it did decrease by a little bit. You should always explain the sort of conduct that you expect from other people, whether it's a formalized code of conduct or whether it's just a sentence or two that's basically like, this project does not tolerate jerks. If you're a jerk, you're going to have to leave, period. The reason that you want to set to create a conduct file when you're just starting out with a project is that it's exceedingly difficult to do this after you need to do it, right? Because what'll happen is you don't do this at the beginning. Somebody comes along 6 months later as your project starts to get a little bit of traction and they're a jerk. And then you add this conduct file that says, hey, don't be a jerk, right? That is not going to end well. It's not going to diffuse a bunch of tension. If you do it at the beginning, it takes 5 minutes, and then it's an insurance policy. It's there when you need it. We use the contributor covenant. You can use really whatever you like. Packaging, I'm actually going to skip this section in the interest of time, but I will post these slides so you can see it. You'll need an installation file that explains to people, look, this is how I install this software, whether it's a pip install, or whether there's just a series of manual steps, be sure to document all of this stuff. Every project should have a license. Even if you don't select a license, one of the things that people fail to realize is that if you don't select a license for your project, a license is sort of more or less going to be selected for you by the nature of the way that people choose to use your work. And believe me, you would much rather make that decision than have somebody else make it for you. So a lot of times what will happen is that you'll go out, you'll put this project online, and then you'll sort of wait, you know, for fame and glory to come your way, and it won't happen. You'll be like, oh, open source is dumb, I hate this, right? I put all this work in and nothing really happened. There is a little bit of promotion that may need to happen. When we first started Salt, we went out, started going around. The first thing that Tom, who originally wrote Salt, did is that he wrote it to solve a problem in his day-to-day job, right? He saw a problem that he needed a solution to. He wrote a solution, and he said, hey, this works pretty well. The next thing he did is he started going around to user groups, and he would call them up, and he'd say, hey, I'm Tom Hatch, and I wrote this software. It does some things. I kind of like it. Do you mind if I come to the user group and spend, you know, 5 minutes showing it to people? And user group organizers are like, oh, thank goodness, right? Because it's a terrible job to try to come up with content every month. And they get really excited if you call and volunteer to come and talk about what you've been doing. And so I cannot imagine a case where a user group organizer is going to tell you that you can't come and talk about your work. Of course, you can announce it on MailInglist, do all the sorts of things that you might expect. If there's no community around your idea, just simply make one. I want to end up by talking about this guy. This guy is named Pedro. You can see by his GitHub graph down there that he's quite prolific. During, I think, last year, he got ranked as one of the, like, five or six, I think, in terms of the most active Python contributors in the world. But Pedro is such an interesting case, because what happened was we started this project in 2013, went around, did our things, talked to some user groups, and all of a sudden we started getting all of this code coming in from this one guy that lived in Portugal. And first he wrote this elaborate logging system, and we're like, wow, that's cool. And then he wrote this elaborate test system, and we're like, wow, that's cool. And finally we reached out and we're like, hey, this is great. You know, thanks for all this code. Like, what's going on? As it turns out, he had a job where he was an engineer at a television station. And so he would sort of start the TV program, and then he would have kind of like an hour to kill while he was basically just sitting there monitoring it, that he could kind of do whatever he wanted so long as the TV program was going out. And so he filled this time up with doing this. And simply by just writing code and participating in all of this stuff, not only did he get recognized as one of the top Python contributors in the world, he got offered a job. Nowadays, he gets offered jobs by all kinds of people. Thankfully, we've been able to retain him. But he did all of this just out of nothing more than curiosity and personal interest. He wasn't concerned about anything else. And so finally, I want to talk about where we are here. You know, African users on GitHub increased from 4,000 to 12,000 in just 2 years as I was doing a little bit of research, which is astonishing to me. And so, just like Pedro, I think there's an opportunity, of course, for the people who are in this room. We can see that you know, around the continent, there are a couple of hotbeds of activity. We should be able to come back in 1 year and change the nature of this map, so that this country is one of the largest contributors. And it's not going to be you won't be able to depend on the person sitting next to you to do that. It's not going to be somebody in the back. It's going to be you. You're going to have to be the one who decides to commit yourself to participating in this community, to exhibiting the sort of bravery that it takes to launch your own projects, to exhibiting the sort of courage that it takes to participate in existing projects, and to change the nature of this map. So I hope that that we're able to do that, and that in a year we can come back and this map will change and it'll look like that. That's it for me. I put all of these slides up on my GitHub account. In addition, I also wrote some sample issues and things like that, and a sample README and all this stuff that I talked about. So you can go there and download all of that and use it as a skeleton for your own projects and refer to any of this if you need to. So I do apologize for running so over time. I'm very sorry about that. But thank you for your patience, and thank you so much for inviting me here. And thanks also, of course, to the Python Foundation for their kindness and generosity. I really look forward to getting a chance to talk to all of you over the course of the next 2 days, and let's have a wonderful conference. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Mike. I think we just take two very short questions. Mike? Oh, you're taking questions? Okay, just two. I've just been told that tea is ready. Questions?
Sorry, I just want to ask, I don't know a lot about you. I was just curious, how old were you when you started programming, and how long have you been programming?
So for those who didn't hear, the question was, how old was I when I started programming? I actually had a slide in this, an earlier version of this deck. That was the first slide. I started programming. Is anybody in here aware of the fact that Timex, that makes watches, used to make computers? So in 1982, Timex decided that they were going to get into the computer business. They partnered up with a now defunct company called Sinclair. And they released the Timex Sinclair 1000. You can Google it. It was a tiny little computer, and basically what it was is it was a keyboard. You would plug it into your television. And again, this was 82, and so I was a young boy. and it had no operating system, and what would happen is you would power it on, and a minute or two later you would get one prompt with a blinking cursor. I remember very clearly it was a right bracket, and it was the basic programming language. And that was it. That was what you had. There was no graphical user interface, there was no web browser, there was none of that. There was a blinking cursor. And so if you wanted to use your computer, if you wanted for example, do word processing, you wrote a word processing program. And here's the terrible thing about that, is that by default, when you turned it off, when you lost power, everything went away. It got reset. So the program that you went, you would have to rewrite the next time. And the only way to avoid that was to buy, they didn't, this was way before hard disks, and this was way before floppy disks. It terrifies me that there are now some people that don't remember floppy disks. This was way before any of that. And honestly, there are people who won't even remember this, but they were cassette tapes, like the sort of cassette tapes that you would put in your car, right? And you would put this specialized cassette player in. You would plug it in, and then you could save the code that you wrote. And if you were very lucky, it would work right, and it would write that on the cassette. And then if you were extremely lucky, at some point in the future, you could get that back off, and you could run the program, you know, the next day. It was the early 80s when I started. It was on a Timex Sinclair, and it was just with the basic programming language. And I was telling somebody earlier that that I really miss those days, because not to get too nostalgic, but things were much simpler, right? And if something didn't work, usually it was quite clear why something didn't work, right? You didn't have 84 microservices, right, all running in the cloud, and you know, who knows if it's Amazon that just tipped over in the Northwest or whatever it is. You know, if you made a syntax error, it said syntax error, and then you started over. It was really a delightful way to write code.
Hi. So my question was about the open source. So when you're developing and you have all of these projects, I've noticed that some of them will often use another project in their project. And specifically, I was thinking of Kivy and how the database management isn't so great, but I'd love to be able to port what Django does to that. So I wanted to know from a open source developer, how do they feel when that happens? Obviously, they then get the credit for it, but how's that viewed?
Right. So open source developers do not like it typically when projects just get forked, right? You know, if you follow open source development closely, there'll be huge amounts of drama about a forked project, right? Like Docker was sort of facing some threats about this recently. And typically forks are just seen as like an outright rebellion, right? Like, you've done a bad job, we're going to take our ball and we're going to go over here and we're going to do it a different way. You know, it's happened with, I won't even get into that. When it comes to just using bits and pieces, typically people are all right. You need to certainly pay attention to the licensing and understand what the licensing implications of that decision are, right? If, for example, you take like GPL v3 and you try to smash it into your Apache license, you're going to have problems. In terms of culture, you know, transparency always matters, and acting in good faith matters, right? It's typically not really great if somebody happens to find out after a fact, right? Like they were just Googling and found out, oh my goodness, somebody took a bunch of code. If you reach out to those developers with your proposal, it doesn't need to be in an issue tracker. Typically, those sorts of discussions happen privately, right? So you email the code maintainer privately and you say, this is what I'm considering doing. I've looked into the licensing. I feel like it'll be okay. Basically ask for their blessing. We get those sorts of requests from time to time. Typically, so long as it doesn't violate the Apache 2 license, which is the one that we use, we're good. We use licensing as sort of the authoritative source, but it's still polite, of course, to communicate and act in good faith.